today, we're going to read another chapter in the book of Exodus, and it will be chapter 3 in the book of Exodus. So, let's get into the reading, shall we? I have the Bible upside down. Okay, so we're going to call it Moses Flees. Yeah. Well, that's just what it says on top. It says, in chapter 3, it says, "Now Moses kept the flock for Jethro, his father-in-law, and the priest of Midian. And he led the flock to the backside of the desert. And it came to the mountain of God, even in Horeb. The angel of the Lord appeared unto him in the flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. And he looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire. And the bush was not consumed. And Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight. Why the bush is not burnt." And then it turns over to the burning bush in this book. It says, "And when the Lord said that, and the Lord saw," "and when the Lord saw that he turned aside to see, God called unto him of the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. He said, Here am I. And he said, Draw not nigh hither. Put off thy shoes from of thy feet, for the place whereon thou standest is holy ground. Moreover, he said, I am the God of thy father, to the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon God. And the Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people which are in Egypt, and have heard their cries by reason of their taskmasters. For I know their sorrows, and I am come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians, and to bring them up out of the land, which a good land, and a large, upon the land flowing with milk and honey, unto the place of the Canaanites, and the Hittites, and the Amorites, and the Perizzites, and the Hivites, and the Jebusites. And therefore bring the cry of the children of Israel is come unto me. And I have also seen the oppression wherein the Egyptians oppress them. Come now, therefore, I will send thee unto Pharaoh, that thou mayest bring forth my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. And Moses said unto God, Who am I? That I should go unto Pharaoh, and that I shall bring forth the children of Israel out of Egypt. And he said, Certainly, I will be with thee, and this shall be a token of thee, that I have sent thee when thou hast brought forth the people of Egypt, ye shall serve unto this mountain. And Moses said unto God, Behold, when I come unto the children of Israel, and shall say unto them, The God of your father had sent me with you, and they shall say to you, What is his name? What shall I say unto them? And God said unto Moses, I am that I am. And he said, Thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, I am hath sent me unto you. And God said moreover unto Moses, Thou shalt say unto the children of Israel, The Lord God of his fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, had sent me unto you. This is my name forever, and this is my memorial unto all generations. Go and gather the elders of Israel together, and say unto them, The Lord God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, of Isaac, and Jacob, appeared unto me, saying, I have surely visited you, and seen that which is done to you in Egypt. And I have said, I will bring you out of the affliction of Egypt unto the land of the Canaanites, and the Hittites, and the Amorites, and the Perizzites, and the Hivites, and the Jebusites, unto the land flowing with milk and honey. And they shall hearken to thy voice, and thou shalt come thou and the elders of Israel unto the king of Egypt, and ye shall say unto them, The Lord God of Hebrews hath met us. And now let us go, we have beseeched thee. 3 days' journey into the wilderness, that we may sacrifice to the Lord our God. And I am sure that the king of Egypt will not let you go. No, not by a mighty hand. I will stretch out my hand and smite Egypt with all my wonders, which I will do in the midst thereof. And after that he will let you go. And I will give this people favor in sight of the Egyptians. And it shall come to pass that when ye go, ye shall not go empty, but every woman shall borrow from her neighbors, and of her and of her that sojourneth. In her hand jewels of silver, and jewels of gold and raiment, and ye shall put them upon your sons, and upon your daughters, and ye shall spoil the Egyptians. So, yeah, that's chapter 3. So anyway, now we're starting to get somewhere. So anyway, thank you for watching this, and stay tuned for another teaching of the Seventh Seer Youth Group. So anyway, thank you for watching this, and have a wonderful day.
Just do all you can. Just serve the Lord. I mean, just serve Him with all of your heart. The Lord, He'll bless you. And things will get done in your life. We were at court today, and Sister Brenda told a lady, a stranger to us, but a young girl, and told her, if you want your kids back, said, you will do, and you better do what they tell you, or you won't get them back. They'll go to somebody else. Said, if you want them back, said, you better do everything they tell you. Well, she came back out of the court. She went in before we did, and she didn't have a smile on her face. Things didn't go the way she had planned. She had her lawyer there, and it didn't go the way she had planned. Brenda told her again, if you want your kids back, you will do what they tell you.
Right.
Amen. If you don't, that's what the Lord says. If you want victory in your life,
yeah.
If you want my blessings in your life, yeah, do what my word says.
Yes.
He loved me. He said, keep my commandments.
That's what He said.
Yes.
Yes.
Praise God.
Praise the Lord.
If we want our life just to go up and down and not amount to anything, then just ignore the Lord. Ignore His word. But if you'll pay attention to His word and grab hold of God, He'll tell you what He'll do in your life. All right. Who's got some money? Just like a preacher, huh? All right. All right. Who's going to put in the most tonight, girls or boys? Okay, you guys are going to need this then.
Yeah.
glad to have William here tonight. Yes. He's going to minister for us. All right.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, did you guys bring your Bibles tonight?
Amen.
Huh?
Yes.
Who brought a Bible tonight? Any kids bring a Bible tonight?
I have one on my phone, but my phone is dead.
Your phone is dead? Well, what kind is that? Here, get you guys a Bible over there, all right? Get you guys a Bible for tonight. All right, boys too, come on, get you guys a Bible. Don't worry, my Bible's on here too. All right. I got 54% of my Bible. But I won't use up all my Bible. All right. You guys turn to the book of Psalms. It's in the middle of the Bible. All right. Turn to the book of Psalms, chapter number 90. All right. Whoever's there first, lift your hand and say amen.
I can't see.
Whichever kid is there first.
I get in the front.
Say amen. Psalms chapter number 90 and verse number 12. Psalm 90 and verse number 12. All right. Are you there, Jackie? All right. Can you read that for me?
Bingo girl.
Amen. Give her a hand tonight. Yes. Amen. Amen. Psalm 90 and 12 again says this. So teach us to number our days that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom. I don't know how long I'm going to be tonight, but I do know that God has something for us here tonight. And I want to speak for a moment or two just upon the subject of God's plan for your life. Say that. God's plan for your life. All right, point to your neighbor now and say, God's plan for your life. All right, that's what we're going to learn tonight. All right, all right. All right, let's pray. Close your eyes, bow your head, let's pray. Heavenly Father, once again, we come to you in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, I ask you, Lord God, for your anointing tonight, God, that you would help me to deliver your word, God, as you've intended it to be brought forth. I pray, Lord, for preaching clarity tonight, Lord. I pray, Lord God, against distraction in the name of Jesus. I bind it in the name of Jesus that the word of God would go forth in demonstration and power of the Holy Ghost. In Jesus' name, and all the kids said,
Amen.
Amen. Amen. You know, it is in the heart of every true child of God to discover God's purpose and God's plan for their life. You were not brought into this world by accident.
Right.
You hear me now? You ain't here tonight by accident.
Amen.
Your mom did not conceive you one day by accident, but God had a specific plan and purpose for your life. And it is God's desire that His perfect plan be fulfilled in your life. But let me tell you something. There's another person that's got a plan for your life. You know who that is?
Satan.
It's Satan. Yeah. The Bible lets us know that his plan for your life is to do three things. Steal, kill, and destroy. Say that with me. Steal, kill, and to destroy. But you see, you don't have to let hell destroy your life. You don't have to let the devil make a mess of your life. You know, where I pastor, there is a young girl. She's probably maybe a little younger than me. And it's very sad. From the 2 years that I've been pastoring, I've seen this same girl. She's a prostitute. Very young woman. But hear me. Don't laugh. Listen to this. Listen. You know what I saw yesterday as I picked up some children to take them to Rush? I see this young, beautiful black girl. And guess what she was doing? She was kissing a 70-plus-year-old man. Now you say, Pastor, that's just silly. That's what I'm trying to tell you, what a disgrace her life has become, all because she's failed to have God fulfill His plan in her life. I deal with people that walk around yelling up in the air. I've had people walk into the church, I mean, totally demon-possessed and crazy, throwing the stuff on the ground. How would you like it if somebody walked through that door, started getting those trees back there, throwing them on the ground, runs up to the pulpit, gets your notes, and throws them everywhere? I'm talking about crazy people. But you see, she didn't wake up crazy. She didn't just become crazy one day. She failed to serve God, and Satan has totally stole her life. He's killing her, and his ultimate plan is to destroy her and to send her to a place called hell. You say, well, Brother William, I'm very young. God, I don't have to worry about these things. You know what? That's what everybody out on the street thought too. They thought, I've got all my life to get right with God. I've got all my life to serve God. But you know what? They're still serving the devil. They're still serving the world. They're still laughing when the preacher's preaching. They don't want anything to do with God. The Bible lets us know that we've got to remember the Lord in the days of our youth. You guys, man, I wish, you know who grew up in this church? Me. I grew up in this church. And you know, I wish to God I had every Tuesday night the same opportunity that you guys have to be able to come and to gather with other kids and to lift my hands and worship God and to learn about Him. You see, I didn't have that. I had Sunday school teachers. I had this and that. But you know what? I didn't have the same opportunity as you guys do to every single week learn about the things of God. Let me tell you, when you stand before God one day, you're going to give an account to every time you heard my younger brother Aaron preach to you. You're going to give an account to every time my dad has preached to you. You're going to give an account to every time you heard the gospel, but yet you sat there and you laughed and you smirked and you refused to give your life to Christ. What a tragedy it would be to go to Tuesday night service every single week, but still end up in a place called hell. Going to kids' church don't save you.
Amen.
Say, going to kids' church, getting picked up by the church, that doesn't save you. There's only one thing that can save you, and that's a born-again relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. What are we preaching about tonight? God's plan for your life. Amen. Number one tonight, God's first plan. Say, first plan.
First plan.
First plan. God's first plan, say that.
First plan.
All right. God's first plan for your life is that you be saved.
Amen.
Amen. That's God's first plan for your life, is that you be saved. Amen. The reason why God sent His Son into this world in the first place was that you might be saved. Bible says in John 3:16-17, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Listen to this. For God sent not His Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through Him might be saved. The Bible says in Luke 19 and verse number 10, for the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost. Over where my church is, we just had an outdoor revival. That means that we're preaching outside. And you know who preached the revival? My baby brother. Well, one of my baby brothers. Now, Aaron preached the revival, all right? So Aaron's out there, he's preaching, telling these drug addicts and prostitutes and old people that have been in and out of prison and on drugs. He's telling them there's only one way to God, and it's found in Jesus Christ. You know what? There were people in the alleys that were listening, people sleeping behind the dumpster that were listening, and you know what they were hearing? They were hearing God's original purpose and plan for their life. They were hearing the gospel, hearing that they needed to be saved. Who in here has accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? Lift your hand. Say, I've asked Jesus into my heart. Amen. If everybody should lift their hands. If you don't know God, He is here tonight, and you can avoid these pitfalls and tragedies that lie ahead of you. God's first plan is that you get saved. The Bible says in Mark 8, 36 through 37, for what shall it profit a man if he gain the whole world and yet he loses his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? You know, I've grown up in this church. I've sat on those orange pews more than most people have ever been to the church in their life. I've been in God's house my entire life. And you know, one thing I remember is Dad telling a story about a man, I forget his name, but he was a very wealthy CEO. What's a CEO? Anybody know?
Like a person in business.
Right, as a business person.
A really big
person in a company. That's a good definition, all right? The chief executive operator, whatever. I've never been a CEO. Well, I am a CEO, technically. But not of a very big company. All right, anyway, so Dad was telling, he said there was this very wealthy man. This man was so rich, I mean, he had gobs of money everywhere. He probably blew his nose in $100 bills. He was that rich. But guess what happened? You know where he ended up? He ended up laying on a hospital bed. And he wasn't there to get his tonsils taken out. He wasn't there to get his gallbladder taken out. He was there because he was about to die. There were so many wealthy individuals that were in this hospital room with this dying man. Well, guess who walks in there in the midst of all these big shots and important people? It's this guy over here. He's not that big shot, right? Here comes Dad. Dad walks into the hospital, and you know who that rich man wanted to talk to? Huh? He wanted to talk to my dad. You know why? Because my dad held the words of eternal life within his heart. That rich man knew, I'm about to die. I'm about to go to a place called hell. I don't know. Maybe his feet started feeling the fires of hell. I don't know. But there was something in him that said, I must talk to that preacher because he's the one that can tell me why I was created in the first place. Right. So guess what happened? The man, he can hardly even talk. He's just laying there mumbling. He gets everybody else out of the room except for him and Dad. And Dad tells this man, sir, you're about to die. You don't have long to live. It's time you make things right with God.
Yes.
You know what that man did? Tears begin to come out of his eyes. Could he even speak the words, Dad?
No.
I don't think he could speak them. You don't have to speak. You've got to believe it with your heart.
Yes.
You can teach a parrot to repeat, come into my heart.
Yeah.
But you got to believe it.
Yes.
The Bible
yes.
says if we confess with our mouth and believe with our heart, amen, that we'll be saved. Anyway, well, this man is weeping, he's crying, and I don't want to go to hell. And guess what? Dad tells him, well, just believe this word and with all your heart. And you know what? 45 minutes later, that man woke up in heaven.
Praise God.
Amen.
Praise God.
You know where he could have woken up 45 minutes later? He could have woke up in a place called hell. Why? Because he failed to fulfill God's original purpose for his life. Don't wake up in hell one day all because you failed to realize God's purpose for your life.
Amen.
Number two. So what's God's first purpose for your life? Get saved. All right? Get saved. What do you mean get saved? Well, if you were drowning in an ocean, if I saw Anna drowning in an ocean and I was in a saver, well, that's a candy, right? Yeah, or a preserver. I throw it out to Anna, Anna grabs it, right? I pull her into my boat and she lives, right? That's what God wants to do. So if he's not throwing it into the ocean, he's throwing it into hell, saying, come on, grab a hold of my cross, grab a hold of the word of God, and I'll save you. I'll set you free. I'll give you a brand new life. You were not created to be a failure. You were not created to walk the streets, but you were created in the very image of God to love him, to serve him, to obey him. That's God's first plan for your life. Number two, God's second plan for your life is that you be filled with the Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
Say that, filled
with the Holy Ghost.
All right, filled with the Holy Ghost. All right, the Bible says this in
Acts chapter number 1 and verse number 8. Now it's very important to know you can't be filled with the Holy Ghost until you get saved. All right. Got a second plan. Now this goes for people that are saved now. But you shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you. You should be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the earth. All right. Why does God want to fill people with His Spirit? Why would God want to baptize us in the Holy Ghost? Hear me now. God's desire and His purpose in sending the baptism of the Holy Spirit was not to just make us speak in tongues. It was not just to make us dance around and shout every now and then, even though those things will happen if you have been filled with the Holy Ghost. But you see, God sent the Holy Ghost to empower us to fulfill the will of God. Can you say amen? The purpose of the infilling of the Holy Ghost is to empower you to live for God while you're at school, to empower you to live for God when your parents are fighting, when they're drunk out of their mind, when you see them shooting heroin up their vein. That Holy Ghost is there to empower you to still live for God and to not be affected by the filth that you have to live with. That's why you need the Holy Ghost. That's why, number one, you got to be saved and you got to be filled with the Holy Ghost. You know what? I was saved at 8 years old. Who's 8 years old in here? Anybody 8? Everybody looks maybe a little older than. Are you 8 years old, buddy? All right. Come here. Come here. Come here. 8 years old. Look at this guy. He looks a little ornery, huh?
Are you ornery? Huh?
8 years old. I was this guy's age. I was about to say size, but I was probably like that. I was about 250, if you know. Come here. Hold on. 8 years old I was when I got saved. You know what happened? We were on the way home from church, and Mom and Dad were listening to a song about the rapture. What's the rapture? Well, it's when Christ comes, catches this church out of here. When I got home, at 8 years old, this size, this maybe this tall, I looked in the mirror, and I began to cry. Mom and Dad ran into the bathroom. What's wrong? Are you hurt? Are you sick? I said, I don't want to miss the rapture. I don't want to be left behind. You know what? They led me to the Lord at 8 years old. I gave my life to Christ. Thank you. Go sit down. But at 15 years old, who's 15? Come here. Come here. 8 years old. Thank you, buddy. 8 years old, I gave my life to Christ. All right, well, 15, I was kind of outgrown Mickey Mouse, but all right. So, I'm sorry. 15 years old. All right, same age as her. You know what happened? You know where I got filled with the Holy Ghost? I did that church. I lifted my hands. About 15, 20 old ladies surrounded me. My arms were tired. I wanted to put them down. They say, you got to let go and let God. I'm thinking, what do you mean let go, let God? I don't know what's going on. Well, but let me tell you what. After three nights of lifting my hand, I didn't know everything that was going on. But God put words in my soul. I began to speak them out. God filled me with the Holy Ghost just like that. I woke up the next day to go to school. I wasn't going to school like I normally did. I didn't just put my backpack on, but I went over. Thank you, sweetie. You can go sit down. Thank you. I went over to my room. I grabbed my burgundy Bible. I put it on my side, and I walked out the front door of the house. You know why I was carrying a Bible now? It's because God filled me with the Holy Ghost, and He empowered me to fulfill His calling on my life. You know what happened? There was an old lady across the street from where we lived, and she had a sign during Christmas time. You ever see those manger scenes? Like they got the little statues. Anybody ever see them? I think I'm losing you, buddy. You all right? You awake? All right. You know those manger scenes? All right. Well, guess what? Somebody stole baby Jesus. I know. If anybody was ever going to hell for something, well, guess what happened? They stole baby Jesus. They put a sign in front of their house. And it said, whoever stole our baby Jesus, I hope you burn in hell. That's what they said. Well, guess what? After I got filled with the Holy Ghost, Somebody died across the road. It was that lady's husband that put that sign in her yard. But you know who had been empowered now to go in to pray with that lady? It was me. Before that night, I got filled with the Holy Ghost. I loved the Lord. He lived in my heart. According to the Word of God, He lived in my heart. But I wasn't empowered to do what He's called me to do. After God filled me, I started preaching, going around different churches, and God began to open up doors, and then He called me to pastor, and now that's what I'm doing. I'm fulfilling the will of God. I'm not like other people that I went to high school with. I've been out of high school now, I think, for 12 years, I think, now. I'm getting old. Well, I'm about to be 30. I'm getting real old. Well, let me tell you about some of the kids I went to high school with. Some of them put guns in their mouth, blew their brains out. Some of them hung themselves. Some of them in and out of prison. Some of them I see them walking around my church. Some of them I see them walking up down where I live on Barnett Street. But let me tell you, that's not where I am. You know why? I let God fulfill His purpose and plan in my life. Not only did I let Him save me, but I let Him fill me with the Holy Ghost and empower me to live this life that the Bible tells me to live. You've got to be saved, number one, and number two, you've got to be filled with the Holy Ghost. You've got to have a desire to be filled with the Holy Ghost. All right, number one plan, what is it again? Just the kids. God be saved. Thank you.
Yep.
Number two, what's God's second plan for your life? What is it? You're listening. Fulfill your life. Close.
Be filled with the Holy Ghost.
Be filled with the Holy Ghost. Good job, Jackie. All right. Hello. Still too slow. All right. Be saved. Be filled. What do you think number three is? Well, don't answer. I don't know. Be obedient.
Yes.
He just went like I'm just going to be wrong. Be saved. Give your life to God. Don't end up on crack one day. Don't end up in prison. That's stupid.
Yes.
Don't do that.
Right.
Love God and live for Him.
Yes.
Yeah.
Boys, God has a wife for you one day. Beautiful children for you. Girls, God has a godly man for you one day. Yeah. But you'll miss out on God's will if you don't submit to Him.
Right.
Right. Number one, be saved. Number two, be filled. Number three, be obedient. Say obedient.
Obedient.
Say it three times.
Obedient. Obedient.
All right. If you're happy and you don't have your head. If you're happy and you don't rub your tummy. If you're happy and you know it, shake your arms and do like this. If you're happy and you don't, say I love you, Jesus. That's a little bit of a sign of sense, Andy. God's third plan is that you learn to be obedient. Like Dad was saying earlier. Total submission unto God. Lord, what do you want me to do? And you got to do it. Listen. God called me to be a pastor at 15 years old, and I'm here tonight. Why? Because I was saved, I was filled, and I was obedient to what He's asked me to do. What is it? Many of us raised our hands tonight. But what is it that God has called you to do? What is it that God has called you to do? Now, I live with little boys. And I got one little bad girl that's somewhere around here. To them, God's will for their life is like, well, I'm going to grow up and be a Power Ranger. All right? That's not God's will for their life. All right? He's got enough Power Rangers. It's not God's will that you grow up to be the greatest baseball player. It's not God's will that you grow up to be the next John Cena doing fake wrestling. All of those things, that's not God's will for your life. Let me tell you what ain't God's will for your life. It ain't God's will that you just grow up and have the greatest education that there is. Hear me now. It's not God's will that you just grow up and you make a lot of money. Because let me tell you, you can have the greatest education, the most amount of money in your bank account, and you can still go to hell.
Amen.
But it's God's will that you be saved, be filled, and you be obedient.
Yes.
Now, Jesus said this, and I'm almost done. John 14:15. If you love me.
Right.
Yes.
Say, keep.
Keep
my commandments.
Commandments.
Jesus said, if you really love me like you say you do, you're going to keep my commandments. All right? Our love for God is tested by our obedience unto him. Hear that, kids? Listen. Our love for God is tested by our obedience unto him. Now, I'm married to my wife, Miranda. She's not here. She's taking care of our youngest baby. But you see, I can tell her I love her all I want. You can come to kids' church and say, oh, I love you, Jesus. You can hear you sing, there's power, winter's over, wonder work. You can go through the motions. That don't mean nothing.
Right?
Your love for God is tested by your obedience. If Jesus says, jump, you need to say, how high? If he says, run, say, how long, Lord? Right? Our love for God is tested by our obedience. But sadly, there are many Christians. They get saved, and they just stop right there. Mom, you can come to the end. They get saved, and they say, well, God saved me, so being filled with the Holy Ghost, that's for extremists. That's for the real religious people. So I got God in my heart. Now I'm just going to sit right here and I'll go to church Sunday morning only. Don't ask me to go Sunday night or Wednesday. Amen. Why? Because I got a life. Who's God to think that I need to go any time other than Sunday? Guess what? God requires total obedience.
Yeah.
Amen. Many people get saved and then they get filled with the Holy Ghost. They run around, they dance, they speak in tongues, they shout, but they don't ever fulfill the will of God for their life. Why? Because they haven't learned to be obedient. See, God wants us to be saved. He wants you to accept Christ into your heart. And he'll live in you. And then he wants you to be filled with the Holy Ghost. Can't be filled until you're saved.
Right.
You're saved. Then, after you've been saved and after you've been filled with the Holy Ghost, it isn't, well, I'm going to come to church, jump around, shout, dance, and this and that. Now, God ain't interested really in that. Why? Because that's not why he filled you.
Right.
He filled you to fulfill his calling on your life. What is the calling of God? Go out into all the world and preach the gospel. That's God's plan for your life. There's three things. Be saved. Be filled. Be obedient. You love Jesus tonight. Huh? Just lift your hands up to the Lord. Say, Lord, help me tonight.
Lord, be free.
Help me. Come on, open your mouth. Say, Lord, help me to be obedient unto you. With every head bowed tonight and all the eyes closed. Now listen, I'm not asking you whether or not you've said the sinner's prayer. I'm asking you if you're really born again. If Christ really lives in your life. You know he lives in your life whenever throughout the day you think about him. Whenever you wake up in the morning, you say, Lord, I love you today. Lord, what do you have me to do today? That's when you know you've got God. Are you hearing you say, Brother William, that's not me. I don't really know Jesus. I go to church, but I don't really know. If that's you, would you just lift up just between you and God? No, I don't need to look around. And let's not just lift our hands just to lift them, but say, I really want Christ to live in my life. Just lift your hand. Are you here tonight and you say, Brother William, I'm saved. Jesus lives in my heart. I know that. But I know God wants me to be filled with the Holy Ghost. That you just lift your hand tonight. God wants you to be filled with the Spirit. It's his greatest gift to his children is the baptism of the Holy Spirit. You're not too young to be filled. Don't listen to the devil. You're not too young to be filled. You need to be filled as early as possible. Maybe you're here and you say, I need to be obedient. That's this preacher's hand. I need to be obedient. I want to be obedient, whatever he calls me to do. I want to be faithful to fulfill it. Amen. Amen. Let's all gather around. come to these altars tonight. Let's just seek the Lord.
Coming back, the Lord did say, if on his